Actively listening to me just shows that, you know, you actually care about, you know, what the other person is, what the other person is saying, and what they say matters.
Welcome to a special edition of The State We're In. Today we'll hear from students at Franklin Pierce University in Ringe who are part of a summer program exploring politics, the media, and the future of democracy. All simple topics, right? We'll hear what they've done and what they've learned and what impact it's had on them now on The State We're In. Hello, I'm Melanie Plenda. Welcome to The State We're In. Today we're here with four students taking part in a week-long Franklin Pierce University summer program exploring some of the central questions of our time, including what's the state of our democracy. Joining us today are Joseph McLaughlin, Atak Natali, Brady Kershaw, and Colin Struckman. Thank you all so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you very much.
So as we record this show, you're about halfway through. So what have been some of the highlights for you? And this time, let's start with Atak.
Some of the highlights for me were being able to experience men on the street and just going out in the public and being able to get opinions and different values and, you know, also being able to listen, actively listen to other people's perspectives. And it kind of put me in that learner position.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Yeah. How about you, Brady?
Well, for me, you know, some of highlights that have really stood out to me is we've gotten to hear from some really interesting people. We got to hear from Atak and I did an interview this morning with Dr. Pierre Morton, and yes, on Monday we heard from the head news anchor over at WMUR for News at Noon, Gene Mackin, and they had some really interesting like things to say, and their stories were really inspiring, mm-hmm. and they shared some really like choice knowledge that I think will stay with me for a long time.
Interesting. Did it change your impression that you may have come in with about journalism and journalists in particular?
I'd say it definitely, like while I understand like what their job is, it definitely gave me a more like enlightened perspective into the work that they do and the actual process that comes with being a journalist, especially in today's world.
Sure. And how about you, Colin?
I would say one thing was the lunch we had yesterday with two editors of the Concord Monitor and Sarah Pearson, Ali Jinwala, and learning kind of the importance of journalism, and especially in an era where technology has kind of taken over and social media has really taken over what we consume as news, and learning how local stories can still touch people and have an impact. And it's kind of an art form that's lost a little bit of its value, mm-hmm. but they're still doing a very good job conveying it. And then myself, Atak, and Joseph did a podcast yesterday with AJ Kierstad, who used to go here, graduated somewhat recently. Yeah. And it was really entertaining to hear what he had to say on some important issues and how kind of rich his answers were.
Excellent, yeah. And how about you, Joseph?
I would say the highlight for me so far on this presidency and the press program has to have been the trip to the State House and talking to Secretary of State David Scanlon and the encounter with Governor Sununu, and be able to ask them about public service and the state of democracy and issues that are going on with politics at like the moment. And I found that very interesting.
And being someone asking an official a question versus maybe reading political news or reading that kind of news, how did that feel different? What did you learn from that experience, do you think?
It felt different in the sense that I got the inside scoop, it kind of felt like, instead of a editor's filtered version that just goes out into the news. I got like the firsthand experience of what goes on in like the New Hampshire government, at least, you know, in the State House with Secretary Scanlon. So that feeling was very different, and I very much enjoyed it.
So I know that during the program you've been doing a lot of interviewing, and now we're turning the tables on you, so it feels better to be asking the questions. Am I right about that?
Yeah.
So I know one of the questions you've asked was, where do you get your news? So I'll ask you guys, where do you get your news, and has that changed at all since you've been here? So let's begin with Brady.
Sure. Well, for good majority of my life, was never really interested in the news because, you know, always hear the kind of constant thing, nothing good ever happens on the news. If you hear about it on the news, probably is not a good thing. So I was like, you know, I don't really want to like deal with that. So never really paid attention to it. And then with the start of COVID and some of the much more pressing social issues that arose, and I was seeing everywhere on social media and hearing it from my friends, I was like, you know, I'm going to start paying more attention. So I listened to a lot of NPR, New York Times, Washington Post, and it's really important to me to feel that I'm connected. So I listen to or read the news pretty much every day. And I wouldn't really say that, like, my sources of news have changed. I've definitely gotten a larger appreciation for the vast amount of sources that there are, and how, especially in today's day and age with social media and everything, how easy it is to access such news. But I wouldn't say that my sources have really changed.
How about you?
I don't think my sources have really changed where I get my news. I would say probably the nightly news on NBC, mainly with Lester Holt. I just admire how professional he is. And then just reading, you know, the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal occasionally. But social media probably is the biggest player in the game when it comes to news, like Twitter, checking it every day. It's easy, it's accessible. It doesn't mean it's right all the time.
Right.
You might have to check it later, but it's a start to something if you'd like to read about the news.
That's an interesting perspective too, because there is this double-edged sword with social media. So can you talk a little bit more about that? Because it is easy access, but there is this sort of, danger, if you will, of misinformation. So how do you kind of manage that? And what do you think about that in terms of social media and getting the news from social media?
For me, it's the ability for anyone to put anything on social media. I mean, you really have a lot of free range on what you can put out and what goes out to what people can read or watch on apps like Twitter, and Facebook, Instagram, anything like that. So I think it's hard to filter out what people are putting out there in their opinion and what's actually the news.
Right.
Well, my family and I, we get a lot of our news from like ABC News, like our local stations in South Shore, Massachusetts. That's usually where we get it, as well as ABC News, ABC World News Tonight with David Muir is one that we usually watch. We also use the cable news networks of CNN and Fox News to get both sides of that argument. I like to use the Wall Street Journal sometimes. Different sources like that, like magazines like The Week or something like that. Just a lot of varied stuff, both written and television, just to get a variety.
How about you, Attack?
I first started off like getting my news from my local news, and then I kind of moved over to YouTube and then branched out to TikTok. But what I noticed about TikTok is the news can be somewhat misleading sometimes, and like photoshopped, and like it can really mislead a lot of people and give a lot of people the wrong information. But it also just makes me, you know, question, you know, other resources, news resources actually, to see if they're also authentic. And what I learned this week throughout this program was looking for other news sources. Because, you know, just staying in one news source can sometimes, it can really hurt, like.
I see what you're saying. Like, if you just, it can kind of narrow your way of thinking, or
yes.
It can kind of be almost like an echo chamber. Is that kind of what you're, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And so it sounds like from this, you might branch out a little bit more. What do you think? how do you think the program has impacted where you'll get your news next?
Oh, I will for sure definitely look at other news resources that I've never looked at before and just try to give them a chance and try to even compare.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Great. So let's also talk about finding your voice in the public discourse. I know that's another theme that you've explored. So have you given that some thought? And where does your voice fit in? And Colin, this time we'll start with you.
I think it can fit in anywhere, really. I think especially with technology and it being such a huge part of our daily lives, that's one of the main platforms that I can use, anyone can use to voice their opinion. And some people might take advantage of that, but I know that it also can be beneficial.
I never really gave the thought of my voice in the public discourse prior to this program, but I'm glad that it was one of the themes because it's given me more thought and it's dawned a light upon it. And it showed me different ways that you can like show your voice and how important that is, especially in the like the state of democracy and things like that. Expressing your opinion is like a very important part of democracy, and without it, democracy wouldn't be the same. So I'm very grateful for that, and I'm happy that this program has that.
Excellent. How about you, Attack?
I believe that, you know, everyone's voice matters, and whether it's, you know, making art or, like, you know, writing a song or, you know, writing poetry, you know, there's always a message in something. And I believe that people should, you know, be able to speak up on what they believe in, you know, if it really has a really big impact. Mm-hmm. It can really have a big impact, for sure.
Yeah. I'm curious, too, especially after being in this program, you know, for halfway through anyway, do you have any thoughts to follow up with you, Atak, on how do you weigh out, like, as journalists, where we're supposed to be neutral and our voice is kind of, you know, should be at least in the background or not there, you know? How can we as journalists help folks have that voice, have that platform? What should we be doing, do you think, as journalists?
Well, I kind of see journalists as a leader in the public eye for their viewers, you know, as they, you know, gather information and from the public and also being able to report that information back. But, you know, I believe that journalists should be able to build that bond and relationship with their viewers and actually, you know, be able to listen to them.
Mm-hmm. Yep, excellent. And how about you, Brady?
That's a really good question. And to kind of like echo what my friends have said here today, everyone's voice matters. Your voice matters, my voice matters. Everyone has something to say. And whether you have a huge platform to be able to project that and say what you think, great. But if you feel like that you have no one to listen, that doesn't mean you shouldn't say anything. Because there's always someone there who can hear you, especially on the dozens of platforms and means of communicating what you want to say that we have today, that you have the ability to do that, and there will always be someone there to hear you. And speaking up and sharing your voice doesn't necessarily have to be in a public setting. Sometimes the most effective projections are on a small scale, whether that's one-on-one or to a small group of like your community. And we've heard some stories this week that have really like brought that message across, that sometimes it's the one-on-ones that have the biggest impact on the community.
Excellent. One of the skills you've been working on this week is interviewing. And I know some of you have gotten a chance to practice that. What was that like? Let's start with a talk and then just
there's actually two main skills that really stood out to me this week was being an active listener and being able to ask like open-ended questions, because you know when you do ask open-ended questions it leads to even more questions and even more answers too. And actively listening to me just shows that you know you actually care about, you know, what the other person is, what the other person is saying, and what they say matters.
I learned a lot about courage. Man on the street interview is very intimidating. That is something I've learned, and definitely something to expand my outside of my comfort zone. Because I've done interviews before with some politicians for like school projects, but at least with that you're like preparing and you kind of talk with them beforehand. This was like a cold call. You never met them, and you go in and see what's up. And it was interesting, and it was very fascinating, because you got to see what like the public thinks. And as hard as it is to do that, and as scary as it can be sometimes, it's honestly a valuable skill, and I'm happy that I got the opportunity to do it.
And how did people react to you, by and large?
Not too bad. I think I played it a little bit worse in my head.
Sure.
That's usually what I do. But it wasn't too bad. I think most people didn't want to talk, because that's kind of sometimes what the public can do, but there were some good talkers that wanted to voice their opinions.
Excellent. How about you, Colin?
I think I learned how to just simply have a conversation with someone, and you know, it can be formal, but I think it's better when it's not, when it's just one person asking another what they believe in, what their values are, what their opinion is, mm-hmm. how can their voice be heard in a way that kind of transcends. So I think it's valuable to get that hands-on experience and talk to people you've never met before, and then talk to important figures in the public eye. So you kind of get a mixed bag of different responses and can gauge what people believe in and learn what a person is like.
Excellent. And so you mentioned you've also visited the State House and met some pretty interesting people, including Secretary of State David Scanlon and Governor Kristi Noem. So what did you think? What did you learn there? And what were some of the takeaways? Let's start with you, Joe.
I learned a lot. I would say definitely some takeaways is just how polar like politics is and how divided a democracy is. I remember talking to Secretary of State David Scanlon. I remember talking to him about like the voter ballots. Like one side is like, we want to make it easier. The other side wants to make it harder. And just how there's less and less middle ground as time is going on. And it's more people are going to the extremes. And his like hope for like journalists like us to kind of bring back that middle ground. And that was something that was very fascinating to me. And that was probably one of my favorite lessons I learned. So.
Really interesting. Yeah. How about you, Attack?
What I learned was the sky's the limit. If you want change, be the change. Mm-hmm.
Excellent. And how about you, Colin?
I would say getting to talk with people like that and learning how personable they are was really valuable. And it's something you don't really see a lot in a lot of politicians in our country. But just seeing how they interacted with all of us and other groups that visited the State House,
Yeah. They
were very open to having discussions and really talking about what the job is like on a daily basis and what they believe in the media and its role. And they're very respectful of everyone and whoever chooses to report on them.
That's really interesting. Yeah. So I know you're still in the midst of your conference, but given what you've learned so far, what do you think about the state of our democracy? And what role do politicians and the media play in that? And let's start with you, Colin.
To be honest with you, I don't think it's very good with the state of our democracy right now.
Yeah.
I think you have kind of a cage match between both sides where it's tough to find out who is going to come out on top. And if one does, the other suffers, while Americans can also suffer at the same time because we can't find that middle ground. Mm-hmm. We can't find kind of that equal balance where it's helping the country. I think that's what the focus should be right now, is helping the American people, but instead it's turned into one side against the other, mm-hmm. social media kind of creating that divide, and it just continues to grow. But I have hope that it'll change. I mean, I think it's possible. It might be a matter of time till we see that, but I think it's definitely possible.
Let me ask you this, and it kind of touches on the question of the role of the media in this, but like, we do see a lot of, you know, conflict between the two parties and in independence, but in your everyday regular life, do you see that same polarization? Like when you go to the grocery store, or hang out with your friends, or you know, go wherever you go, Or do you think there's sort of a disconnect between that sort of what we see is happening in America and what we experience in America? What do you think about that?
I think that disconnect is kind of what I'm getting at. And that's a great way to put it.
Yeah.
Because you might not necessarily see it when you go out in a public setting.
Yeah.
But when you really consume any media, you can see it. Yeah. And it might not be clearly stated, but there is a divide. And it's sad that a lot of issues in our country, like gun control, like the Roe v. Wade being overturned, it's not turned into what's better for the people and helping Americans. It's more one side trying to win the battle because they have values that they're trying to push for the country.
Interesting, yeah. And how about you, Joseph?
I would second what Colin is saying. I don't really like the state of our democracy right now. I do fear some days of the future of politics. I feel like politicians mostly nowadays are more power hungry and they're doing it more for themselves instead of the people they represent. That's just how I feel about it. But and I think the media has done both a good and a bad job representing that. There's been some that go right to the extremes and just say this is good, this is bad, but while others are trying to give that equal representation. And that disconnect that you were talking about, I do really notice that. When you're talking in a public setting, it doesn't really come up as often, but you usually only hear it really on the news or at like some kind of rally or some kind of protest of some kind. So I think if we can just find that middle ground and work together and compromise on a lot of these issues, I think we can really heal our democracy. It's up to us.
You attack.
I would like our democracy to listen to one another, to listen to one another, because I want people to leave out the judgment and the bias and to actually like try to have a rich conversation rather than just throwing ideas at each other and just are constantly arguing. I mean, you don't have to agree on something, but actually try to listen to one another.
Yep, yeah. Exactly. And how about you, Brady?
Yeah, to kind of echo what these guys have been saying, I have a lot of days, a lot more now than I have really ever before, where I really question the security of our democracy and the state of our country. I feel like I see a lot of, on the news today, no one's really rallying to unite the country as a team or as a, hey, we all live here, so let's just do what's best for us. There's a lot of blame cast, especially by politicians in a sort of, as it comes across to myself and some of my friends who I've spoken with, as almost an attempt to radicalize groups to form a very strong conflicting divide and really messes up progress. And I've seen a lot of people who have said, I don't like everyone who's running the country right now is ruining it. Well, it's up to us to fix it. Because we're next.
Yeah.
So if anyone's going to do anything, it's going to be us. So start thinking, start coming up with ideas, start talking with people who don't have the same views as you. And don't just get all upset that they don't have the same views as you. Just talk to them and see if you can find at least some sort of understanding, because compromise is key if it's going to be successful.
Well, hearing your answers, you guys give me hope for the future of our democracy. I'll tell you what, I think you got the right idea. So finally, this goes to just what you guys were talking about. So how do you see your role in democracy? And has that changed, in the last week or so? So let's start with Joe.
I say my role, I am thankful to be now 18 years old and I can exercise the very important right to vote. And I would say that's definitely a role that we all have, that we can exercise the right to vote and vote the people that we want in power. And we also have the right to assemble, to share our opinions, to own our opinions, as well as like demonstrate and go out like into rallies or protests and to like be passionate about what we are passionate about. And that is the role that we have to play.
But you attack.
I feel like my role would probably be, because like I kind of see it as I'm somewhat of a role model to my younger siblings, and so if they see me, you know, having conversations maybe with them about, you know, the world maybe, or just, you know, trying to make a change, then maybe, you know, a thought in their head will maybe be like, oh, maybe I should make a change too. So that's how I see it.
Good. How about you?
Yeah, to kind of echo what Joe was saying, I also recently 18, and the right to vote is something that not only I'm like, guess excited to have, but I'm proud to have it, because it's a huge responsibility. And there are a lot of people who have that right and don't use it, which is their choice. But if you don't use your right, then how can you, I guess, complain about what the state is right now? Because you didn't advocate for change for yourself. And I feel like saying that if you don't vote, you're part of the problem is harsh. But I mean, if you see a problem, you can cast your vote to try to change it. And I think that's something that a lot of these upcoming generations need to be aware of, is that you being able to vote is a huge responsibility. And really, if you want change, you're the only people who can advocate for it. And you're the only people who can say what you believe, and people speaking for you isn't effective, because then they just rope in what they want and preach it like you want it as well. You need to represent yourself.
Yeah. And finally, how about you, Colin?
I would say, like everyone has said here, voting is probably the most important part. And everyone has that right to vote. It doesn't matter what party you're affiliated with. Whatever you think is best, vote for that candidate. Whether it be in the presidential election or a local election, it doesn't matter. So if you can fix whatever's happening locally, maybe that influences another state, maybe that influences the rest of the country to follow along with that change. But I think that's the main way that, you know, change can be made, and then really just voicing your opinion, whether it be, let's say, a peaceful protest or on social media in an effective way, that can really advocate for change, and it can reach millions of people as well.
Absolutely. Well, I hope you all had a great week and can't wait to see what comes next for all of you. Joseph McLaughlin, Atak Natali, Brady Kershaw, and Colin Struckman, thank you all so much for being here and for participating in this program. It's very important.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
The conversation continues online. What do you think about the state of our democracy? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHDemocracy. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.